And welcome once again to ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Applebee's. We come to you from Raymond James Stadium, home of Super Bowl 43, the Buccaneers, and of course, the USF Bulls. Their fans are ready. First home game since they knocked off Kansas, and that's what's helped catapult USF once again up into the top 10. And welcome, Chris Fowler, Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Aaron Andrews will join us. USF guys starting to become more established. It was a year ago this time, they were ranked number two. And then on a Thursday night at Rutgers, the face plant. They lost three in a row. So Grothy says the focus this year, get up there and stay up there. Handle the situation better than they did. There they are at number 10 because of all the upsets last weekend. But keep in mind, guys, all the teams in white, they're going to play each other in some combination. If USF can keep winning, and they should be favored in all or most of the games, they're going to find themselves right in that BCS mix, perhaps undefeated out of the Big East.
Yeah, but you know, the one good thing about it is they have learned from the past, especially Jim Leavitt. Here's a football coach that knows now how to prepare his team to handle emotionally the rankings. So he's come out and he said, fellas, focus on your game and yourselves. Jim Leavitt, there he is, running the guys full of energy and intensity, and that's what makes him special. The players here love their head football coach, and they play for the guy, but they have to be very aware tonight because Pitt already has a loss, so they're playing with their backs against the wall. They don't want another loss. They got to focus, though, South Florida on their own game.
On the other side of the field, Pitt came into the season ranked, and they stumbled against Bowling Green that first week. A lot of people wrote this football team off, but they've strung some wins together, and they got a great opportunity here tonight if they get this win to really get back on track this season. And if you look at the driving force behind Pitt's offense, it has to be their running back, LeSean McCoy, and he's a good one. Last year set a Big East freshman rushing record with 1,328 yards. He's a big back, but he's got that sprinter speed. He had his best game of the season this past Saturday against Syracuse, so he's feeling it. This USF defense has to do a good job tackling in this football game. If not, guys, we could have yet another upset here on Thursday night.
We've had four in a row. They call McCoy shady. He's pretty slippery, tough to tackle, and he's going to be the focus for Jim Leavitt's defense tonight. Here's the coach with Aaron Andrews.
Coach, look, there's been a lot of talk with Pittsburgh about their back, LeSean McCoy rushing for 149 yards last week. How do you plan to stop him tonight?
Well, you know, he's a good back, and it's not going to be easy. He's going to get some yards. I don't think there's any question about that. You know, we've got to play within the framework of our defense and certainly have great pursuit and get off blocks. And, I mean, there's no secret to the whole deal. You know, he's a good back, and we just got to do the best we can, you know, with, like I said, just getting to the ball carrier.
A lot of people are curious to see how you'll handle, the team will handle the ranking. What have you preached to them about that?
We don't talk much about it because, you know, they've been around long enough now to know that where you're at right now doesn't mean, you know, a whole lot. Every head coach says the same thing. Everybody says it's all how you finish at the end of the year. It's all, that's what really matters.
I don't see any blood. How many guys have you headbutted?
Only about 16.
Thanks.
The Bulls won the toss, deferred, so Delbert Alvarado will boot it away, and Pittsburgh will go on offense first. Ron Stevens Howling, Andre Wright are deep. This is Stevens Howling, the backup tailback. Bounces it, can't quite get the corner, and the Panthers will start from their 23-yard line. They're led out by Bill Stull, injured his thumb last year, had to sit and watch, very frustrating. He's a guy that they ask basically not to lose the game, but they might be more aggressive with him tonight. Try to take some shots, Jesse.
They expect to take some shots. This is a big game for Bill Stull here tonight because when the shots get called, if it's not open downfield, he's got to be disciplined enough to check it down or throw it away. They cannot afford bad plays.
They had three crucial interceptions in the loss at home to USF last year. Two of them taken back for touchdowns. Stull was not the quarterback in that game. Very first play, and there's some confusion, and Stull will be hit in the backfield by Keon Wilson, the middle linebacker. So Wonstead talked about making bad plays and handling the environment they don't in the first play.
Well, you know what, in the short week, you know, you've got a lot of enthusiasm. Wonstead tried to temper the enthusiasm of his team, but this is a big game. This is a setup game for him to find out where they are for the season.
It sure is. We talked about Bill Stull earlier. He's a very emotional quarterback. He's a guy that, you know, when bad plays happen, it tends to kind of wear on him a little bit. He kind of wears his emotions on his sleeves. He's got to put these plays behind him.
Second and 13, Derek Kinder, the top receiver, goes in motion. Almost intercepted. It was broken up at the line of scrimmage. Bowie got a hand on it. And now it's going to be third and long.
And you know, when you talk about an opening series here,
Stahl's not a guy that's going to put the team on his shoulder and beat him with a passing game, but he's got to be quicker and smarter with this.
That's one thing the defensive ends from USF do such a good job at in games. They're able to pin their ears back and get upfield, get those hands up to knock balls down.
And third and 13. Pressure from the edge. A shovel pass. McCoy has it. This is Shady McCoy, but he can't make enough Bulls miss to get the first down. Danny Verpale, the safety there on the stop. Panthers go three and out.
When you talk about starting the game for Pitt, they felt like Wanstead did, that he could come out here, spread this group out, and have success early, Jesse, especially with this offensive line taking advantage of the upfield pressure.
Yeah, and there's so much speed on USF on the defensive side of the ball, and we saw good examples of that here in these last three plays.
Dave Brightus, who's a black belt in karate and also a mixed martial arts fighter, tough punter, and he'll kick it away to Marcus Edwards of the Bulls. It's almost blocked. They run into him, and here comes the flag. There's going to be a penalty on USF. I don't know how they didn't block it. They were all over Brightus. Didn't get the ball. Slam into the punter. And he's a tough guy, so you don't want to slam into him, but you better run away.
Well, they got there too fast. he overran the block angle. You know, and everybody tells you, take the ball, take your hand, put it where the foot is. He just overran the leg.
Yeah, you got to be better about that. As a player, you have to understand where that punter is, where the leg's going to extend to. Like you said, Craig, go for the ball, but stay out of that swinging, that arc from the punter.
And it was Quentin Washington. He was there, as you said, in plenty of time to make the block. Kind of flinched. They kind of came away from the leg of the punter. So that moves the ball to the 43-yard line. First big mistake of the game goes to USF. McCoy, the tailback in the I formation. Panthers do a lot of shifting pre-snap, kind of NFL style. Matt Kavanaugh is the offensive coordinator. Give it to McCoy. And jumping off sides in there. It looked like big Keith McCaskill, the tackle. Let's see if he was drawn. Nope.
Number 91, 5-yard penalty. Second down.
This is a very emotional defense when they play here at home, USF. They kind of feed off this crowd, which it may not be a sellout, but they make a lot of noise here. But just a little keyed up, too keyed up.
It's a nice job by Bill Stahl changing up the snap count. When you're playing on the road in hostile environments, mix it up and try to quiet this crowd down.
You see George Selby, the fine pass rusher, on the sidelines. He was going to try to go tonight. He's had a high ankle sprain. Missed last week's game. Second and manageable, but down goes Stahl. And that was McCaskill making up for his mental error with the sack.
Well, USF's defensive line, they felt the challenge coming their way tonight. Everybody's talked about how Pitt was going to get after the D-line. Six men come. Offensive lineman not passing off. Mistake on the left side by Jason Pinkston, the left tackle.
It was Keon Wilson also coming on the blitz. They are all over that Panther offensive line in the early going. Goes from second and medium to third and long again. This time they rush only four and they dump it off to McCoy, but a long way to go with the first down, and he gets nowhere near it. They're not going to have much success if they're third and 13 all night.
They got to do a better job, obviously, of setting themselves up to convert these third downs. On that last screen pass, though, LeSean McCoy caught the football. There were no offensive linemen out in front of him to block.
That's a problem in a screen.
That's a little bit of a problem in the screen.
I never like seeing that as a running back. I always hated to see no big fellas with me.
What's going on?
We'll try this again now. Brightus. Marcus Edwards deep for USF. This time they don't come after it. Try to set up the return. Edwards inside his 10. Twist forward to the 18. So Matt Grothy and the USF offense will get their first possession after a 48-yard punt. First possession for USF coming up. They're led by the junior quarterback from Lakeland, Florida, Matt Grothy, been a starter since his freshman year, also leads the team in rushing.
He's got quicks. He's tough, accurate thrower, good touch. Not a huge arm or all that, quick release.
Yeah, but Pitt wants their defense to make sure they push him to the perimeter. They don't want him running north and south on him. They want to see if they can turn his shoulders and get him sideways. They don't feel like he's as effective outside.
He's just got a knack for making plays, doesn't he? Not a physically imposing guy. Under 6 foot tall. Jamar Taylor is the setback. Fake it to him in the first play, and Grothy looks downfield, gets to the perimeter, and fires complete. This diving catch there by Cedric Hill, the tight end. That was Taurus Johnson. He's their leading receiver. They've had 15 different guys catch passes, 14 different players run the ball, 11 different players score touchdowns already in the first, five games?
Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator at USF, tells his receivers before the game, I don't know which of you guys are going to catch balls here tonight. We'll just go the way the game goes.
They've got five receivers, three to the right, two at the top of the formation. And second and seven, Grothy has time, fires, and drops. Right off the number nine of the senior tight end Hill.
Well, he also says this, Greg Gregory does, the offensive coordinator. If you fumble the footballs running back, you're out of the game. And if you drop passes, they're not coming back to you either.
That's the thing about having a lot of depth. You make a mistake, you might sit and watch it. Yeah, Gregory says that they don't really have an offensive system. They just have a kind of a conglomeration of stuff. And we'll see what he can dial up on third and seven. Third and 12.
That playbook
all
really shrinks.
On the offense. Number 65, five-yard penalty, third down.
He said he feels good, Gregory, about third and seven or eight. He feel they got a lot of stuff in their offense they can call on that down, and this is but third and 12.
Yeah, they do very well throwing the football kind of in the short to intermediate ranges. They're comfortable there. Unfortunately, third and 12, again, that playbook, not that many calls to convert these plays.
Panthers show pressure. That's Scott McKillop, their linebacker, right over the center. And he's coming on the blitz. And Grothy can't get away. Got away from the first man, but that Panther pass rush, Greg Romeus. Rashad Duncan, the tackle, got there too.
Dave Wanstead believes the defensive line that is too deep here at Pitt is outstanding. He could not wait, Jesse, tonight to see them unleash their talent.
Absolutely not. And Greg Romeus, one of those guys, got really long arms. He's really tough to block because he engages and can keep the lineman off of him. And you saw a good example of that right there.
Alvarado, who used to be the kicker and the punter, now just handles the punting, boots it away. And a fair catch is called for by Aaron Berry. So both defenses, quick and stout in the early going, scoreless in Tampa. Well, the four of us and the talent side of things were preparing for the telecast in our notes. Our crew was out there in the beach. That was Lisa Menzies beating all the guys on the ring toss over. That's a nice. See, we're working too hard to have that kind
of. We're just trying to work here. You know, we got a game.
Yeah, there's a guy getting ready with a headgear on, though.
You never know what you're going to see down here. It's a festive scene for the Bulls home games. Second possession for the Panthers. McCoy is the tailback. He's got it on the delay. LeSean McCoy weaving his way through traffic, a very hard-earned 7 yards. Bowie gets him.
One thing that'll be interesting tonight is USF's run defense is fourth best in the country. They're giving up just a little bit over 58 yards
that,
a
though?
Game. You know, this is a different animal they're seeing tonight. You know, it's different when you play UCF, FIU, you play Kansas, who runs the football 10 times or less, Greg.
And McCoy, we need to watch McCoy tonight to see if he's running hard for the 4 and 5 yard gains, not the 20-yard burst. They've been working on that hard.
Officially 6 yards on first down. McCoy has it again. He can't get away. Off the edge, Jerome Murphy, the corner, with the stop. You know, the Bulls are not on the field very much as a defense. They keep the ball a lot, and their opponents have only had it about 27 minutes a game. They don't run that many plays. That's why the stats are pretty good.
Well, the stats are good right there for two reasons. One, if you're for USF, their defense came up secondary strong. Two, from Pitt, McCoy's got to lower his shoulder and get something out of that.
This USF defense heading into tonight's game has held opponents 50% of their drives. It's been three and out. They're able to get off the football field.
You see they're doing it without the star pass rusher, George Selby. And third and three. Still a poor throw. tried to get it to Kinder, threw it behind him, and after a promising six-yard gain on first down, dropped the punt.
That's one key coming into tonight's game also. Dave Wanstead told us when they get into third and two, third and three, third and five, and wide receivers are open, Bill Stahl has to hit those passes.
You know what? There'll be some changes in this offense throughout the night that'll give them a chance to have some open plays. They've got a nice game plan for it, but right now USF's covered them up.
Edwards back to receive the punt. They come after it and block it. The Bulls scoop it up and head for the end zone. Touchdown. Theo Wilson takes it to the house.
He's on the inside. Nobody's there, Jesse. Somebody has to account right there. You got three back there. 83, look out.
This is twice on three punts now that USF has come through clean, and a great job by Theo Wilson just being aware. Scoop and score.
Yeah, it's Carlton Sinclair, actually, number 31, not 21, who scooped it up. But problems with the Panthers and the special teams in the early going. They use this punt formation that they get from the Gators, Jesse. It's the spread formation. It leaves some pretty wide splits, and the Bulls have figured that out.
Yeah, it's one of those things, I think, when you're in that spread punt formation, if not everybody is sound and guys are missing assignments, you can get some clear-cut lanes right at the punter, right in front of the punter.
Stevens howling. Barrels across the 30. That's the kind of early special teams mistake that Wanstead frankly feared in this game.
Well, you just have to count bodies. 1-2, 1-2. This guy here, block out. These two back here, they took the same guy. So you've got a problem with your counting numbers. 2-on-1 leaves one open. Can't do that.
And that was Washington who roughed the punter the first time, making no mistake that time. Sinclair with the touchdown, and now his team, which has played from behind almost all year, faces a 7-0 deficit here in Tampa. The first down throw for Stahl, and the slant is complete. It's a short gain. Jonathan Baldwin is a true freshman. Second catch of the season.
Boy, Jesse, I don't know about that, but you know, when you open up and just look right where you're going with it and you're patting the football, it's telling everybody to go cover somebody over there.
Yeah, you know, Bill Stahl is going to have to do a good job in this game of using his eyes and getting the football out quickly. We mentioned it earlier, Craig. This USF D-line, they can get up the field and into the backfield.
Let's see what they could do on second and three. Nothing's been easy for Pittsburgh, even when they've gotten a decent gain on first down. This is Conridge Collins, the physical fullback, and knee hammers for a first down of the 45. Keon Wilson in the stop.
Obviously now it's up to Dave Wanstead to figure out what's going on. Trying to figure out who's coming from where, who's counting, and who's responsible. You've got to count bodies. It's really simple.
You know, what killed Pitt last year in this matchup against USF was interceptions. And Pat Bosick, the backup quarterback, threw two to the house. He almost threw another one, but this Pitt team, they can't turn it over. You can't afford block punts getting scooped up to score either. You got to play more sound to stay in this football game.
Yeah, Pittsburgh led in that game, Jesse, 14-7, and the Bulls reeled off 24 straight points at Heinz Field. Here's a first down. They'll take a shot downfield, but way overthrown. He's trying for T.J. Porter. Nothing there.
poor execution. When you see all the green jerseys back there, nobody's fooled on the play action. That means to me the offensive line is standing straight up.
And if you're going to take a lot of shots as an offense, your quarterback better have time. And so far in this first quarter, guys, Bill Stahl has not had a lot of time to set up. It's going to be very difficult to push the football downfield with the kind of time Bill Stahl has gotten so far tonight.
Steven Talling is the tailback behind the fullback Collins. Ball been in motion. And Stevens Howling is small guy, just 5'7", 180. But we've seen a lot of small guys do really well on Thursday night the last couple of weeks, haven't we? It's almost an advantage to be under 5'8 these days.
Hide back there and hope that you're not 6'1 or 2. I think Pete Carroll would echo your sentiments there.
It's funny, Craig. You and I were talking about it. We were watching Lerod Stevens Howling on tape. And for a guy that's 5'7", 180, he runs a lot tougher than his size would indicate. He runs almost as if he thinks he's 230.
Yeah.
He's a bruiser for a little guy.
Another third and long. They need seven. Stahl wants to go downfield. Throws it up. And running under the ball is Jonathan Baldwin for a touchdown. First career touchdown for the true freshman from Aliquippa. 52 yards.
There are no real fast guys on this offense at wide receiver, Jesse, but the double moves and the time to throw the deep ball is what they have to work into it.
They're going to have to try to find creative ways to get downfield. You see the true freshman, Jonathan Baldwin, on the double move, and a beautiful throw by Bill Stahl just to float it up and over and has allowed his receiver to run underneath it for the touchdown.
It's a true freshman beating a senior corner in Tyler Roberts. Connor Lee never missed a PAT. In his career, just snuck it through the upright. I almost put the jinx on him. He's 86 of 86. That was pretty close. Body paint. Not a fan.
Well, I think Jesse would say speak for yourself.
Well, some wear it better than others. On third and short, this is Ford. A tough run. Mike Ford hurtling down to the 10. And here come three penalty flags on the play. They came in late in the run.
Holding on the offense, number 89. 10-yard penalty, third down.
And you got the senior receiver, Torres Johnson. It wipes out a 14-yard gain.
Well, first of all, Jesse and I were sitting up here, and Greg Gregory has told us that on third and two, they've been terrible. They've been trying to run the football, so we're thinking pass.
Yeah. Like, and having said that, all of a sudden, now this penalty is going to set him back. You almost wonder if this USF offense, you know, still isn't built to maybe convert this. You got to be careful now, though, because now you're kind of bordering inside this 30-yard line. You want to stay in field goal position. Third and 11, a little bit different.
Now you see that Greg Gregory wants a timeout. Grothy calls it. And so it'll be third and three.
You know, some of that, when you wonder, that's a weird number for them. They said last year they went back and looked at all of their third and two situations, and they were 8 out of 10 when it was third and two. You know, they were throwing the football.
Right.
So this year they've been trying to, you know, square peg, round hole, and so, hey, well, okay, let's go back and let's throw it on third and two.
And they gassed him right there with Mike Ford. That was a huge hole for one of those short yardage third down situations. You don't expect to get those on
offense. When you go and tackle the linebacker, though, around the legs,
that helps the hole, yeah. Especially downfield.
That's a problem.
Key thing, though, this momentum has been kind of pulled back and forth. Bulls with the crowd roaring got the lead on the punt block, and Pittsburgh a nice answer. But now Grothy with the first real substantial drive of the game for the Bulls. Yards so far. This is play 9 on the drive on third and two. They give it to Ford again. Drives the right side. Hard collision. He won't get there. Austin Ransom again, the converted receiver, ex-safety, now playing linebacker, but a very tough guy.
Well, when you're trying to kick out block, that means you're going to run up inside, right? And when you miss the kick out block and you try to bounce outside with the running, that usually equals no success.
That's 0 for 2 right there on third and two on this team trying to convert their running the football. Craig, what you were just saying, we might start seeing USF go back to throwing it on these short conversions.
Mike Benani, the Brazilian-born freshman kicker, the hero of the Kansas game. He kicked the game winner with 000. It's blocked. And the Panthers special teams rise up and make a play. They try to lateral the ball, and they'll be knocked out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Wanchek says, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Redemption for the special teams.
I don't think he was talking about the lateral.
You don't think he was that excited about the,
not the lateral.
Big guys trying to make a play on the sidelines?
Outside here, you know, he is excited, though, about his special teams coming up, making a play.
That's now the fourth block for Pitt this year. They've only played four games heading into tonight. That's their fourth block already.
Would you have coached up lateral that ball like that right there?
Oh, yeah. I might have had a few words with my guy coming off the sidelines. Let's not get careless here, fellas. 7-7 football game.
As Aaron Berry, who's the starting corner, he came off the corner out of the starting blocks and made the block. McCoy fumbles the football. USF falls on it. Nobody can keep momentum in this football game for very long. That's a crucial mistake. Exactly what Wanchek talked about with Aaron in the pregame. The bottom of the pile coming up with the football. Number 42, Wilson, the linebacker.
I really believe McCoy's problems. Look how he swings his arms. This is a habit that he has. It's a terrible habit. When you're in traffic, you have to know the presence of mind of where the people are coming from. And you can't run for 15 big yards. You've got to worry about the short gains.
Terrell McClain forced the fumble. And so Grothy right back to work at the 34. Ben Williams is the tailback. He takes his turn in there, the senior from Lake Wales, Florida. And Grothy, a first down throw. Five. Short gain. The completion in front of Berry. Back to football on second and five. Grothy fires incomplete. He fired it hard, and A.J. Love could not come up with it.
Go ahead. That was a look defensively for Pitt right there, where they were showing what we call cover zero. There's nobody deep. And if USF can get a completion and keep it on the run, that's a chance to gash him and score.
Yeah, and I was going to say, Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, he says, when you stop putting pressure on Grothy, he hurts you. Yeah. We're coming. We're aggressive tonight. We're after them.
You need 5 yards on this third down. Grothy changing it. Six on the play clock to get the snap away. Takes a shot, fires over the head of Hester. He wanted a flag, didn't get it. Pretty tight coverage by Ricky Gary. So we saw something over there, but there were two men in the Panther secondary covering Hester.
Well, Pittsburgh so far has come in this game. They've really challenged USF and their receivers. They played a lot of bump and run man coverage. And what that allows for is these corner routes down the field, but that's a really tough ball to complete. It's got to be a perfect throw, well anticipated. And so far, Matt Grothy has not been able to hit that pass.
So here comes Micah Benani again. Previous attempt blocked a few minutes ago. This will be a career long. It's 46 yards. Only 3 seconds on the play clock. Got to snap it quickly. It's a fake. And they're not going to get it. Grant Gregory, he snapped it just before the play clock reached zero. So some special teams activity tonight. Wow. Block punt, block field goal, fake field goal.
Absolutely. Plays a part in every game. And tonight it's a real big part of this football game. But you know what? You got to be smart over there, too. This defense, they're smart. They understood exactly what the situation was.
Yeah, they kept their eyes on the holder. They're able to make a nice tackle, get the football back. Good awareness, good tackling, because I'll tell you what, I certainly wasn't expecting that at all. I thought that was field goal for sure.
That's Grant Gregory. He's the son of Greg Gregory, the backup quarterback and defensive coordinator. Not able to make that play, and so Pittsburgh is back to work. And McCoy, who just fumbled, tries to fight for yards, and they're hard earned.
You know, going back to
the stop.
Going back to that fumble we saw in the last possession, Craig, you said it exactly right. He swings that football sometimes. He had two fumbles against Iowa a few weeks ago, and that was one of the things the coaches said that he did a better job of against Syracuse this past Saturday. Good ball security, but we haven't seen it yet.
He's been meeting with the offensive line, trying to better understand their theory and strategy and blocking. and they're trying to impress upon him as coaches how important it is to run through tackles, and the big ones will happen.
Yeah, just take those 4 or 5 yards. Don't worry about trying to go 25 or 30 every carry. Stahl flips it out of the backfield. Collins, the fullback, sheds one tackle and gets a first down at the 39 before Carlton Williams stops him.
Really unlike the beginning of a football game right now. I think Pitt's doing a nice job in terms of play calling and keeping these downs and distances manageable. A nice short passing game so they can convert these first downs.
I'm sitting up here looking for old momentum, right?
Yeah.
And if you're the number 10 team in the country and you're playing Pitt, and Pitt, they need to take advantage of this, you know, and there's a little lull. South Florida's not dominating them.
Didn't catch in the turnover. They've had their problems in the field goal team. Going airborne. A nice game, McCoy.
You know what I'm saying, Jesse, though, about that? Do you feel it?
Yeah, I mean, right now, there's no real spark coming out of USF. And granted, they just had a fake field goal that got stopped. And look at this run by Sean McCoy. Talk about sacrificing your body.
Face
there's
mask.
Like a little face mask there by outside linebacker McKenzie.
Yeah.
McCoy still in the game. On second and two. There's a nice job. He kind of cuts it back and is content to get five, Craig, right? That's what you're looking for.
No question. Make your move, get the defender off balance, and then get north and south.
You cannot hit a home run each and every running play. He's done a better job of understanding the blocking schemes, when to put his foot in the ground and get north and be satisfied with the 4 and 5 yard runs.
It's Tony Dorsett with blocking up front from Wanstead in 1973. Had a brilliant freshman year. McCoy actually had more touchdowns last season than Tony did in his freshman year.
We call that the black and white photo days.
Yeah, exactly. This is McCoy on the delay. Looked like he had to struggle to hold on to the football as he spun in the hole. It was a nice gain, and Dave Wanstead back in his offensive line days when you could be a lot lighter than 300 pounds to play, right?
He looks good today, though. Let me tell you, that back then, that guy's a wise guy.
That's not one of those guys I think you'd want to get in front of when he's pulling either.
Look at his eye there.
Look at that nose. That nose is like, you cannot hurt me.
And the nose.
Yeah. That nose, you can't mess with that.
And then Mark May came along, and that whole bunch of linemen, and just the era after Wanstead. This is Stevens howling. They spell McCoy with the 5'7 senior. No gain.
Yeah, backside George Selby, a guy that has a bruised bone just above his ankle. And, you know, they really need to look at the explosion off the ball. Now, as a tight end, AD, you got to know where the ball is going to get your head across that to cut it off.
You have to, but that's the most impressive thing about Selby, what you just said, his explosion coming off the football. And you see him here in the pregame trying to test out that bone bruise, see what his explosion's like. He looked a little iffy when this game started, but he's looking pretty good right now.
He's a guy with 22 career sacks. He's a real difference maker because he occupies so many blockers when he's in there. On third down, Stahl fires near side. It's caught by Cedric McGee. Good job to hammer him out of bounds by Tyler Roberts, a yard short. So a decision for Wanstead.
I think Wanstead's going to go for this. If you look coming into this football game, his football team has been very good on fourth down. They're 7 for 8 heading into this game. They got real physical up front. I think this is a no-brainer if you're Pitt.
And if he didn't go for it, he would be going against what he said to his football team all week, and that we're going to South Florida to be aggressive. We're coming after you.
He did say that. That's the mantra all week in all phases, and aggressive play calling included in that. Conridge Collins is the fullback. McCoy the tailback. Stoll's got it. He flips it short, complete to Collins. They throw it on fourth and one and convert.
You know, I said earlier that Pitt's offensive line was not selling the run for play action. Well, you watch him here. This is outstanding up front, but the offensive line selling the hardcore fake up the left side.
That shows a lot of confidence in your quarterback right here. It's fourth and one. You're calling a play action bootleg throw, even though that's a relatively easy throw to make. They very easily could have turned around and handed that ball to LeSean McCoy.
And They'll hand it to McCoy this time. And LeSean McCoy weaving his way into the secondary, muscling down inside the 15. Nate Allen finally there on the stop, the best run of the night for the Panthers, 19 yards.
Joe Thomas on the right side, and the right side, watch the conversion that they have here. Look at the explosion. Big 56. Look at that hole.
I think one thing we're going to have to look for here, Craig and Chris, is that there's not a lot of depth on the defensive line right now for USF. All that linebacker, and when these guys can't rotate, they might start getting tired. You're going to start seeing a better push from this Pitt offensive line.
Panthers, as you saw, very efficient in the red zone this season. Hammered is McCoy, and Wilson knocked him back. They've scored every trip into the red zone, and they've had touchdowns in 10 out of 13.
Right, but the last thing that South Florida wants to have happen is for Pitt's offensive line and that running game to get going.
Craig, when you look at this run, do you like the hesitation from LeSean McCoy right there? It looks like he's jittering. Would you like to see him just kind of hit it?
You just got
to
get up in there. Get on up in there.
Still on second and 10. Fires to the corner of the end zone, and a flag comes down. There was no receiver within 25 yards. The flag is about the 2-yard line in the secondary. It's going to be against the Bulls.
Holding on the defense, number 3. Penalty behalf of distance to the goal. They go for a pass across the line of scrimmage. Automatic. First down.
And it's Jerome Murphy, a rare recruit from the north. He comes from Elizabeth, New Jersey. Almost every other Bull is from the state of Florida.
Now, keep in mind, this is great position for the Pitt Panthers right now. They've had 13 trips in the red zone coming in. They've scored with 100% efficiency, one of only 8 teams to do that this year. In the 13 trips, they've scored 10 touchdowns. They play extremely efficient when they get inside the red zone.
Penalties once again hurting the Bulls. They had 4. Pittsburgh, the least penalized team in the country, not been flagged yet tonight. This is Stevens howling. Dodges a tackler in the backfield. Cannot get away. Dropped for a loss as Carlton Williams came up, and now a flag comes in. Only Burnham's defense guilty of their 5th penalty.
Dead ball. Personal foul on the defense. After this is the ball. Automatic. First down.
After the tackle.
When that player, the ball carrier, goes immediately to the ground, it's horse collar. And
you know
it's coming.
Yep.
We always talk about who rules. Who are the kings? But now it's real. Because now there's the throne. We are creating a real, tangible, touchable symbol of the greatest rivalry on planet Earth. I want the rivalry to be celebrated through this. This is historic. There's never been anything like this. Who earns the right to sit in the throne of all thrones? The ultimate rivalry throne.
Midway second quarter, 7-7 game. The Panthers set up at first and goal at the Bulls' 5-yard line following the 5th USF penalty.
This is a very thin defensive line. A lot of injuries. George Selby's, Genus is down now. So, you know, you're rotating guys in there that aren't necessarily your first teamers.
Take it to Stevens. Howling. Stall fires for the end zone. Overthrown way over the head of T.J. Porter. And that was Selby, who's really trying to tough it out. He's not close to 100% with that ankle, who got near Stall. And you can see he's having a hard time running on and off the field, much less getting a push, but he's still making an impact out there.
My guess is they're thinking run right now. They bring him out, they keep him in there for the passing and the pressure up the field.
Craig Marshall swings in there, number 94, to replace Selby. Stephen Howland still in the game. John Pelosi, the tight end, motions to the fullback position as a blocker, but he can't get much room for Stevens Howling. And that was McLean filling in for Genus on the stop.
Boy, this is a critical time. Hey, Aaron, is there any kind of a vibe down there on this field? I mean, here we are in a big game with goal line.
I have been running up and down this sideline looking from any sort of vibe, momentum. I've been what? The crowd is finally alive. That's what's been so weird about this. It's like these people are exhausted from the Rays game. It's been weird all night.
Aaron Andrews always in pursuit of a vibe. Stoll, once again, throw to the end zone, jump ball. A flag comes down as Baldwin, the freshman, went up against Roberts. And this Baldwin beating Roberts earlier for the touchdown.
On the defense, infraction occurred in the end zone. The ball be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic. First down.
We talked about that earlier. Now, Pitt does not have a lot of speed at wide receiver, but one thing they do have is great size. And true freshman Jonathan Baldwin is 6'5". And when you get down here in the red zone close to the goal line, you got to be expecting these jump ball throws to these big targets.
Roberts knew he was beaten, just went and tried to make a play with his back to the quarterback, and now it's first and goal at the 2. It's McCoy behind Collins. LeSean McCoy cut down at the 1. It's again Jerome Murphy showing quickness off the corner.
Yeah, he is. But, you know, again, this is a Pitt football team that believes in the red zone. You just told him, Jesse, about the percentages that they have. They've got to get it in.
And if I'm Matt Cavanaugh, the offensive coordinator for Pitt right now, I'm pounding this thing down after down after down and really try to steal this momentum, play physical, and punch this thing in with my big running back, McCoy.
You got 3 tight ends in the game.
Yeah, you know what? And Nate Byam, number 80, he's a guy that you really have to pay attention to. Right side.
And a flag.
False start on the offense. On the 25. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
The first penalty of the night against Wanstadt's team comes at a crucial spot on the field.
But he's had 2 personal fouls against South Florida that have helped him with the horse collar, the pass interference. So
you don't see many false starts in a tailback.
You don't see a lot of penalties from Pitt either. Coming into this football game, tied for first in the nation, only giving up about 2.7 penalties a game. They only had 11 penalties in total heading into tonight.
They're just looking for more room to operate down here.
That's right. Matt Cavanaugh's opening up the playbook.
Okay. McCoy. Hit in the backfield, gets away. LeSean McCoy, foot race to the end zone, touchdown. Tyrone McKenzie, their best leading tackler, had a shot at him. McCoy got away and got 6.
If you're a tackler going against McCoy, watch McKenzie's legs when he lunges. He loses his legs. McCoy doesn't quit using his legs, and there's the result. Missed tackle.
LeSean McCoy's a special runner because he's one of those guys that looks like he's going to try to run you over, but he's got that speed and that wiggle to get away. I think it goes without saying. LeSean McCoy is one of these guys we're going to be seeing on Sundays. There's just no question about it.
McCoy's 6th rushing touchdown, and I saw Terrell McClain, the big tackle, limping off for USF. He was in to replace Genus, who was hurt earlier. So with Selvey hobbled, depth of the defensive line, something we'll have to keep an eye on as the game unfolds. Connor Lee, again, perfect in his career. Penalties really helping out the Panthers in that marathon drive. 15 plays, 72 yards. It took almost 8 minutes, 7:54. Again, McCoy finds the end zone after some assistance from USF penalties. Second and 8. It's McCoy and Stevens Halley. Now they shift that empty backfield. Bulls rush only 4. Low pass. Nice catch by Stevens Howling, but it kind of stopped his momentum. He had to go back for the football. It'll set up short yardage situation. Clock continues to run.
It's great to have that kind of running back who can split out and play wide receiver and not just run little hitches or go routes, but actually run slants and ins and outs. He does a nice job catching the football, Stevens Howling does.
And you already have a very depleted linebacker corps that on this entire squad, they only have 4 to move around. So you put one of those inexperienced guys out there in space, it's an advantage offense.
2 tight ends in the game on 3rd and 2. McCoy. A slow developing play. He was hit in the backfield. Aaron Harris on the stop to clean it up, but excellent penetration by Williams. Clock running inside, 52 seconds to go.
This is a huge stop here by Carlton Williams. You're going to see him just line up on the outside. He's just going to come in unimpeded and just make a play in the backfield, shore up the tackle, keep LeSean McCoy short of that first down marker.
Well, don't you see something like that, though, as an offensive coordinator, and you think, uh-oh, here's a guy pinning his ears back, not responsible backside?
Maybe a big opportunity downfield, huh?
What a nether injury to a defensive lineman for USF. That's Aaron Harris, the junior tackle. Already we've seen Genus and McLean limp out. Selvey's playing on a badly sprained ankle. You guys are going to have to dig deep in that D-line in the second half of this ballgame. Meantime, that was a real good stop. And let's see what happens here. See, check out the interior line. It was a helmet-to-helmet collision.
Oh,
right,
yeah.
Near
oh,
the tackle. Yeah. He collided with Williams, his teammate.
Well, you know, when you talk about what it means now, you've got a defense that, in my opinion, they're not into it right now. They haven't been into it this game. You're losing players. You have guys coming in playing roles that they're not used to playing. You really have to suck it up as football players.
Let's check with Aaron Andrews on the field.
And, guys, just to add what CJ was saying, every defensive player that's walked off the field tonight, they've all been shaking their heads or screaming, I've got three guys blocking me. What do we do? There's a communication issue, and the coaches are saying talk to each other out there. But I haven't seen one guy walk out without shaking his head.
They're shaking their heads because they're in new positions, not used to being blocked from those new angles.
Excellent kicker, Connor Lee, 7 of 8 on the season. This is from 35 yards. For a 10-point lead. And let the clock run down. Wonsett doesn't want to leave the Bulls much time. And they'll call a timeout. Icing his own kicker, but I get the point. Don't leave the ball. Not that this offense has done anything. They have 79 yards in the first half, but Wonnie's playing it by the book there, I guess.
Well, the fact that Pitt has an offense now with 171 yards to that 79 for USF, that's pretty impressive.
You know, USF, they can't get a rhythm. They've only run 22 plays tonight. Pittsburgh almost double that number in the first half. So Grothy hasn't been sharp, but they haven't had the ball much.
No, I like this thought by Dave Wanstead, because while USF offensively hasn't been doing great, you don't want to wake the sleeping giant. They've had 22 touchdowns heading into the game. 14 of those have happened in 2 minutes and 57 seconds or less. It doesn't take this offense a lot of time to get going if they do. So I like what Dave Wanstead's doing here.
But they're used to 77 snaps kind of a game. You know, this offense just is not out there. They haven't set the pads.
So here's Connor Lee from 35. Knocks it straight through. Pretty efficient first half. Wonsett's team gives up the block punt, goes in a hole on the road, and now 17 unanswered points.
I'll ask both of you a question. All right, we've seen some good teams. Does South Florida's bench right now look like the number 10 team in the country?
No.
Does any of the guys on the field don't either, more to the point.
But they just don't look it.
The environment here is strange. It's true what Aaron was saying a little bit earlier. You remember watching these guys play Kansas here at night? It was rocking last year against West Virginia at night. This place is known for being a great environment, a tough place to come in and play if you're a visiting team. And right now, it's just not a lot of energy, not a lot of juice here at Raymond James Stadium.
Totally agree, and these guys haven't really given their fans much to cheer about. Haven't had the football, and the defense is wearing down.
And truth be told, now, here's a Pitt football team that was up 14, blew a 14-point lead against Bowling Green early in the season. Oh, yeah. They feel like they should be 4-0, and many, many preseason experts felt like Pitt might be the team to beat in the Big East.
Yeah, but they also forget that they had to escape against Buffalo. Didn't wrap that game up till late in the game. 1-point win at home over Iowa. Had to escape from 11 down in the third quarter against Syracuse. They could be.
I liked Iowa's victory, though. That was a nice win.
This is by far their best performance, though. Let's be clear.
You're right. It was a good win against Iowa. We think they're a pretty good football team, but it wasn't very impressive still. They scored twice early in that game, and it was just kind of a sloppy win. But you're right. This is the best they've looked up to this point in the season.
The kickoff is short, and there'll be a chance. Johnson stopped short at the 28-yard line. Yeah, I like what Wonsett said. It's like a political campaign. A major gaffe against Bowling Green got a lot of attention from the press. But if you can just recover, if you can keep going forward and tonight make a big statement, maybe the people will forget about what happened in that opening game, losing to the MAC team at home.
When you only have the ball for 8.5 minutes, that puts a lot of pressure on that defense, a defense that was depleted with injuries coming into the game. Here come the boos.
There's a loss. Williams is stopped. McKillop on the tackle. Three first downs for USF. And a total of 77 yards right now. Well, will the surprises continue on Thursday night? Are we headed for a fifth straight upset? The number 10 team in the country, they're huddling on the field before they even go to the locker room.
Yeah. He likes to do that with his football team, but you know.
There's a reason why he loses his voice at the end of every game. I don't know. A lot of theater as he yells at guys in front of the Skycam. Aaron, down to you.
Coach, what was your message there in that huddle?
Well, we just, you know, make a lot of mistakes, you know, and, you know, with penalties and those kind of things. You know, we can't get a field goal blocked, obviously. But, you know, it's a heck of a game, 60-minute ball game. We come out and play the way we can. You know, well, we're a shot winning it. If we don't, then it's a lot like what you're seeing right now.
All right, Coach, thanks.
USF, ranked number 10, down 10 at halftime. A very listless performance by this group in front of their home crowd as Pittsburgh comes in here, plays very well, and jumps on the Bulls, who had the ball less than 9 minutes, 8 penalties, hard time on the third down, had a field goal blocked, couldn't convert a fake field goal. Got the one touchdown from a blocked punt, but Grothy didn't have the ball much and couldn't get any rhythm at all.
No, he didn't. If you're, you know, Dave Wanstead, we'll take the other side of the field for a moment. I would be over there with those young football players, and I would be telling that team, fellas, you're young. Don't be fooled here. You're on the road against the number 10 team in the country. They could wake up, and they got a quarterback capable of getting them back in it.
Remember, USF's already proven that. They were down 17 points to Kansas. They were able to bring them back. This USF team has proven in the past. They play very well in the third quarter, but I think give a lot of credit to Matt Kavanaugh, the offensive coordinator at Pitt. He's done a real nice job dialing plays up, keeping Matt Grothy and some of those playmakers on USF's offense off the field.
Stahl was able to get his offense going with a long touchdown pass. Grothy will get the football first, and USF, you know, some urgency here. Their defense is wearing down. Lots of injuries on the defensive line in that first half. Guys are gimpy. They were on the field a long time. And there's Selby. He's been gutting it out on a bad ankle, but I think that even though it's, you know, start of the third quarter, important for the Bulls to get something going, Craig.
Maybe offensively, Grothy goes to the line of scrimmage and they go up tempo. You gotta wake up the football team.
Riggs to kick it off. And this is Bogan. Dontavia Bogan stops short of the 25-yard line. Our Home Depot coaching adjustments.
Well, you know, Jesse and I talked about this here. What do you do here at halftime? Let's go to Pitt. Pitt, keep the football because you want to play keep away from Matt Grothy. Run the football, LeSean McCoy. Get him up inside and outside and mix it up.
They're doing a very nice job at taking advantage of the pressure from USF. They're throwing little screen passes. You see here, they're running draws, and they've been very smart on when to take chances down the football field, and Bill Stahl was able to make them pay throwing the football deep.
Grothy, only 22 yards rushing, 36 yards passing. That's it. Jamar Taylor is the setback. This is Taurus Johnson on the reverse. The senior runs smack into three defenders over there. Austin Ransom, again, new at this position. Looks like he was born to play linebacker.
Well, he's born to run, that's for sure. 86, Ransom was a wide receiver. You see him on the inside, the middle. There he is right here. Watch how 86 is able to get to the outside.
Austin Ransom's a great story. Was a walk-on, played receiver. He was a strong safety in the spring and was the most active player on defense for Phil Bennett. He was able to move him over to that outside linebacker position. He's done a nice job playing there.
Empty backfield. Pressured, Grothy gets away, dumps it off. It's complete. Good coverage there and a short gain. Cedric Hill, the tight end, run out of bounds as we check with Aaron Andrews.
Chris had a chance to catch up with Pitt head coach Dave Wannstedt. He loved defensive line pressure that they put on Matt Grothy and, of course, the way they controlled the clock. He said the only way we're going to win this game is if we keep Matt Grothy off the field. Hey, guys, in an update from USF's locker room, on a scale of 1 to 10 intensity level, I heard through the grapevine, Jim Leavitt was a 15, no headbutting, no count there, no tally.
Gather the team on the sidelines in front of the camera and try to get his team going immediately. And Grothy on third down near the marker, Mick Williams on the stop. And that was a crucial scramble by the quarterback.
And up the middle of the field. And I think Matt Grothy recognizes that he's got to put this football team on his shoulders, doesn't he?
He does. And that's big right there, converting a third down right out of the gate here in the second half. Find ways to get this momentum back on your side.
He was brilliant against the Jayhawks in that rally here last month. 15 of 19, 204 in the second half. This is Plancher. Waits for his blocker. Lowers the head for four. That was a terrific back and forth game. You know, Kansas rallying late after they'd been behind, and finally the field goal by Benani to win it with 000 on the clock.
And Todd Reesing is a heck of a quarterback, right? You know, a guy very efficient. It was a great challenge, great character game for South Florida.
And Matt Grothy, he went toe-to-toe with Todd Reesing the entirety of that football game.
They're toe-to-toe. I like Grothy. He's also a black belt in karate over old Todd.
Yeah. Wow, we shouldn't have given him such a hard time about his bad hair, dude, the other day.
No Plancher again. They'll try to work it to the junior. Looking for a hot-handed tailback. They've been tough yards from that position. It'll be third and short.
All right, Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, has done a great job of dialing up the pressure at the right time. He has to keep the pedal to the metal.
Yeah, he acknowledged that when teams stopped blitzing Grothy, as Kansas did in the second half, then he kind of was able to make plays. He was very forceful about that. Keep the aggression going no matter what the situation is in the game. On third and short. Hard fought yards for Plancher. He gets a second consecutive first down. Barry on the stop.
Really like this play calling coming out of the gate from Greg Gregory, offensive coordinator. We saw a lot of pass plays. They were trying to move the pocket a lot in that first half. And here they come out in the second half. They're keeping it conservative on the ground, trying to, you know, chew clock. Nice job so far, though.
Look at this. Four receivers to the top of the formation. Empty backfield for Grothy. Instead of throwing left, he comes back right. Lobs it down to Love, who makes the catch. A.J. Love runs under the football, 38 yards.
Yeah, you know what? This, you said it, Chris. You've got four receivers to the left. Really nice job of Greg Gregory setting up his one-on-one with a taller receiver.
And Matt Grothy realizing it. And just a beautiful ball. Just throws it up and over the outside shoulder of A.J. Love, able to go underneath it and catch it.
Giovanni Chappelle was there in the coverage. Now they're going to review this. Looked like Love made the catch and got his feet in bounds, or one of them anyway. Was he juggling the ball? That'd be the question they'll look at with the replay.
Or did he have,
I think he had.
I think he had possession. I think that's a catch.
It's close, though. Yeah. You can see why they're reviewing it.
It didn't look to me like this was even a question when we saw it live, but. You see him try to cradle it. He kind of pins it off his thigh right there, doesn't he?
You know, what's your definition there?
Is possession of the football? I think this is a catch.
You could pin it on your leg like that.
Yeah, I think this is a catch.
Yeah, it's not conclusive enough to overturn, is it?
Either way, I think it's a great job again. The offensive coordinator, Greg Gregory, running the football. Boom, you take a shot.
And that's Love. He's come on as a receiver. He beat out Carlton Mitchell, who was the starter a year ago. Sophomore from Bradenton. Nearby, Tampa.
Southeast High School. That's a powerhouse program down here in Florida.
And he has worked hard to overcome Carlton Mitchell, the fastest guy in the Big East. Big 400-meter sprint guy. And just a hard worker and probably their best receiver.
That's saying a lot, too, because this is a very deep group at USF.
It's a very big review as well. Did they keep the 37-yard gain? Are they set up at the 16-yard line? Or is it backed up near midfield?
You know, there is the longer it goes, the more you think that they're wondering, did he have possession? Was that ball sliding down and he didn't have total control? They're going to rule it on the field
as review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. The receiver had possession of the ball with 1 foot in bounds, first down and 10 for South Florida.
So the first big pass play for USF stands. Right back to work, same formation, four receivers to the left. Love at the bottom of the screen.
We got the one-on-one down here at the bottom of the screen again.
Again against Chappelle.
Press man-to-man coverage. This is a good opportunity to strike again.
This time, fakes the throw to the left and takes off running. Mike Rothy knocked out at the five. So that formation giving the Panthers trouble.
Well, you know what it does here. You opened up. Greg Gregory again opening up a quarterback designed run. He knows he's going to have that single pressed up deal on the right side, just like he had the previous play. And it opens up a soft corner, really soft corner to the right side of your screen.
Now, it's funny. Greg Gregory says that he would take Matt Grothy over any quarterback in college football right now. What a statement that is, considering what Matt Grothy's asked to do here in this offense.
It's Blanchard on first and goal. So they had three first downs in the entire first half, four on this drive already.
Yeah.
Hand off to number three.
Whatever Levitt said or whoever he had butted or didn't had butted, it's worked with this offense that looked so out of sync in the first half.
Number eight's come out. The first down, the third down run that he had on the quarterback draw on the other end of the field, barely gets the first down, then the big throw.
If good things are happening for this offense, it's usually because of number eight.
Yeah.
Second and goal. They have single coverage on Love again. Bottom of the formation. McGrothy fakes the run. Little jump pass in traffic. And a flag comes down as the official hits the deck. They look for Hill, the tight end. Shades of a Tebow kind of jump pass, Jesse, but you shouldn't throw it if it's that crowded, huh?
Holding on the defense. Number 86. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic.
They got ransom. He got away with it, Grothy, there.
I love the play call here. You know, you run the quarterback draw a couple times. That sucks these linebackers up at the line of scrimmage. And you got a big target in Cedric Hill, but you're right. You get down close. You got to be careful where you're putting that thing.
And big 225-pound Mike Ford in the game. Ford has it. Hit in the backfield. Muscles forward. No signal. He stopped short.
Boy, this is where having a running quarterback like Matt Grothy really puts pressure on a defense. You suck up in there, you got to stop the dive back, and you have to stay disciplined on the outside, Jesse, or else he'll pull the ball and he's gone on the boot.
This is big right now for this offensive line from USF. They have four seniors on this O-line. They really need to establish themselves here in the second half.
You know, the ball kind of got near the plane right there, didn't it?
Yeah.
And I don't think he was down. Ford still in the game. On third and goal, Grothy keeps it, powers forward, touchdown. First touchdown for the Bulls offense tonight. Very impressive looking drive to start the third quarter.
Whatever Jim Levitt said to this football team at halftime, it worked. That could not have been a more impressive drive offensively coming out of the gate.
Benani tries to cut it to a three-point lead. Almost as many yards in that drive as they had in the entire first half. Matt Grothy looking for some love. A.J. Love. This big pass setting up the touchdown run. ESPNU All-State mock BCS standings. The real ones will be out soon, but this is using the same two polls, the Harris and the coaches and the computers here. Remember on Saturday, a lot of these teams on the road. Got to be careful with these road games. BYU plays tomorrow night at Utah State. They should win that game.
Can I draw with you for a moment? This one over here, too. That team right
careful,
there.
Yeah.
Careful.
Upset alert for the Crimson Tide.
Just hello, darling.
Kentucky can play some defense. And we'll talk more about the unfolding big picture as the Panthers try to convert the second and two. Stahl steps up. Still got it. Throws to the end zone. Over the hands of Cedric McGee. They took a shot, still being aggressive. So you made a little noise. You don't have a real strong belief, Craig, in the BCS busters from conferences like the Mountain West. You got BYU and Utah. You saw the Cougars there. Utes not yet in the mock top 10, but they will be if they keep winning.
I've been consistent. You and I have worked together a long time. I've always believed Utah's a good football team. Don't get me wrong, but I always say this. The teams in the SEC and the Big 12 this year are being challenged week in and week out. Ole Miss beat Florida.
We're not talking about the championship game. We're talking about just playing in, you know, the fifth BCS bowl game that was kind of created to give a non-BCS conference a chance. You're begrudging them that?
No, but you alluded to the fact that they're beating a team that just beat the number one team in the country. Did he not, Jesse?
No, but I'm saying, you know, you don't think BYU and Utah are good enough
good
to get have a BCS at large, you know, at large?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm talking about national championship.
Oh, no, I didn't mean that.
Okay, okay, good. Glad you clarified that for us here.
Well, I think everybody will always go back and look at Boise State beating Oklahoma and say that a team is...
It can be done.
It can be done.
On first down now, McCoy. Short gain as Pittsburgh continues to try to chew clock inside of 11 minutes to go. And this drive already has taken almost 6.5 minutes.
Yeah, 13 plays, 70-something yards. You know, this is a grind. Hey, Aaron.
I'll say championship game next time. Oh, so you won't get confused. A BCS bowl game versus championship.
I'm all right with the BCS game. Hey, EA, are those guys on South Florida's bench getting depressed or disgusted or discouraged?
Oh, there's no talking. Everybody's putting their heads down. You know, the more and more their defense gets penalized, they just get upset. Are you guys done fighting up there, by the way?
No, not yet. Stahl fires. Sidelines incomplete. It was off the fingertips of Dickerson. We're discussing.
It's an issue. It's a conversation. Jesse, how do you like it?
I understand where the team will be down because it's been frustrating for everybody involved in USF to see the defense with this many penalties, but they got to stop here. Field goal attempt, you're still down just 6.
Yeah, I get the feeling watching this game, though, that Pitt came into this game and they haven't been more of an understanding of what this game means to them. Wouldn't you guys agree?
Yeah, and on this play here, again, Matt Cavanaugh's idea, get close, fourth down, we might go for it.
Ward Selby digs in for the pass rush on 3rd and 8. It's the draw to McCoy, and this time he cannot dance his way to the marker. Tyrone McKenzie with the stop. On comes the field goal team.
Great call. Make this thing so that they cannot kick a field goal and tie it. Make this thing 6 points. And get it out of that. I wanted to say make it a two-possession game. But I thought, hey, wait a minute. 6 points is still a one-possession
game. Chris, wasn't he the guy that told us that one time? What was the deal? 10 out of 10 or what?
After a guy missed making a play, said he'll make it 10 out of 10 times.
Yeah, and you had to correct him, maybe you mean 10 out of 11.
Were we in Colorado? Was there a high altitude?
Here's Connor Lee from 31 yards. Very, very reliable senior kicker. Makes it 9 of 10 on the season so far, but the deficit is just 6, and Matt Grothy and the Bulls go back to work, 9:40 to play. Where Jesse's headed after the game. That little Latin dancing.
That'd be embarrassing for me.
Oh, look, Evan Longoria there of the Rays there, and he's the hero from this afternoon. A couple of home runs, stole a base.
You better get that straightened out. It'll be 0-4 tomorrow.
This is the guy we're talking about right here, okay? That's where you should be focused.
I tell you, that's an 0-4 day tomorrow.
Wow.
Just a little distraction.
It's the big leagues. You can, you know, have fun, go out. He's over the White Sox this afternoon. They misplay the kickoff. Bogan. His blocker and picks up about 10. So the Bulls a crucial drive here, able to force the field goal, still down by only 6. But the way the Panthers have been chewing clock, you just don't know how many more possessions you're going to get in this game.
Yeah, you know, these long drives put a lot of pressure. But again, we've got a fresh defensive line at Pitt. They've been rotating, and McKillop in the middle.
Meanwhile, the Bulls go up tempo. Quickly to the line, hand off to Ford. Big guy shimmies and shakes across the 30. So poor field position after the misplayed kickoff, but Ford in two carries has him out across the 30 already.
USF has to stay up tempo right now. They got to find a way to just keep running plays, get some more offense going in this game. Averaging 464 yards of offense heading into this game. We're only at 161 right now. You got to run more plays to move the football down the field.
They have 42 snaps compared to 65 for Pitt.
Way, way, way under their average. This is Ford. Nice run, Mike Ford. He's starting to come alive now in the fourth quarter. The sophomore who led the team in rushing as a true freshman, showing why he was so highly recruited out of high school.
Well, here's where youth really hurts you on defense. Watch in the lane assignments at Pitt how they get bunched up and overrun their lane assignments, and there's the cutback.
On their last scoring drive, we saw Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator from USF, start the drive this way also. Run the football, suck defenders up into that box so that Matt Grothy can take shots down the field throwing it.
Well, it's coming.
And McKillop was kind of sitting there waiting for him to come to him instead of going after him. And Mr. Ford took a left turn. Ford's a guy who comes from this area, played a high school all-star game on this field, and highly touted again, originally committed to Alabama. Some academic issues, ended up here, and he's been a big boost to this program. Three straight 9-yard runs.
He's, you know, 220, what, 225,
yeah,
maybe?
Yeah, wow. 225, 6'2".
Big guy. I wonder who's going to get the ball here.
He's still in the game on second and one. Ford. Hammering ahead with a 45. It's all Mike Ford on this drive.
You're starting to see that senior offensive line really assert themselves here on this football drive, getting a great push again, Craig, against a fresh defensive line from Pitt.
And you kind of broached on the thought, but this run creates the play action. And again, that youthful Pitt defense better pay attention.
41 yards for Ford, and he's four carries up in the drive, and he's got it again. They just keep feeding him. This time, only a 2-yard gain. There we are on the stop. Yeah, you don't have a chance when you rotate backs as much as the Bulls do to really get in a rhythm typically, Craig. But I think by the fourth quarter, isn't it good to have a guy
lathered up?
Yeah,
absolutely. And especially when he's 225 pounds and starts leaning on the inside.
Ford to the right of Grothy on second and eight. They fake it to him. Quarterback keeper. Grothy makes a man miss. Gets down the sidelines. That was old Austin Ransom as a flag comes in late. Austin Ransom, that speedy backer. Grothy made him look silly there. Huh?
Jesse, did you ever make a move like that?
not on purpose.
Huh?
I ever did not on purpose. That's unbelievable. Matt Grothy in the quicks.
Gave him the dead leg, didn't he?
There's no flag on the play. Play ran out of bounds. First down.
Again, the flag is picked up. An 11-yard run. He's deceptive, I'll say.
And it wasn't a defensive lineman that he shook. That's Austin Ransom, a former wide receiver. Just gave him that dead leg.
You do the hokey pokey, you put your left leg in, you put it up.
I'll be singing. Big guy, Ford, breaking tackles. Ford barreling down near the 20. And this defense for Pittsburgh, which was so stout in the first half, held the Bulls to 79 yards, appears to really be wearing down now.
Time for Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator at Pitt, to dial up at a minimum a run blitz. He's got to keep the pressure. They've been playing safe. They can't do it any longer.
And USF just keeping it simple right now on offense. Not dialing anything crazy up or fancy in the pass game, just pounding it straight ahead.
Ford wrapped up for a loss. That time, Jabal Sheard came off the corner.
This is also a point of the game, too. Ford's had five or six carries in a row. He's probably a little fatigued. I mean, all backs get there.
He's coming out of the game now.
Yep.
Edmund very active all night. Suddenly 53 yards, almost 8 a carry on this drive. Mo Plancher spells him on second and 12. It's Brophy looking to throw. Cuts back, fires to the end zone. Touchdown, Jesse Hester Jr. Run. Set up the pass. First pass attempt of the drive. The touchdown to Hester, his third touchdown of the season. Mike and Bonani for the crucial extra point. Nothing's been easy in the kicking game tonight. Bulls on parade here in Tampa, Florida. Touchdown catch by Jesse Hester Jr. Set up push-ups on the field. Set up push-ups in the stands there. Hester got free against Eric Thatcher. That was a matchup Pittsburgh defensive coaches were worried about. Eric Thatcher's a senior, a solid guy, but against the slot receiver, as tough as Hester. Not a good matchup, and now the kickoff just goes down and rolls out of bounds. Bizarre problems on the special teams, and Pittsburgh will take over on the 40. Just needing a field goal to take the lead.
Got to play effective in all of the areas.
When we go back and look here at this touchdown, first of all, Phil Bennett knows that anytime you don't put pressure on Matt Grothy, he hurts you. They don't. Here's Pitt's defense going back, and they're not really doing anything with it.
And what a throw by Matt Grothy here. This is just a broken play. He's got duress. He's got somebody on his legs. He could not have thrown that football more perfectly to Jesse Hester.
Wally Burnham said, the key in my mind is to put the ball game in the hands of Stahl at the end of it, and he's trying to win the game. I like my chances if I can get him to that.
Exactly, and that's where it is right now. They do have some time. They have the time to still run the ball on this drive. 5:57, 60 yards from the end zone. Stahl's going to still be aggressive. Fires on first down. Has a man wide open. Splitting the secondary is, Derek Turner down to the 22. They're living up to what they said. Being aggressive,
and old Coach Burnham not expecting that kind of play. Boy, you're talking about settle down in the secondary, find the pocket, find the hole, and Stahl steps up and drills it.
It looks like the cornerback here, Tyler Roberts, gets lost a little bit. He just trails and gives Derek Turner too much space on the in route, and that was maybe the most confident throw we've seen from Bill Stahl tonight.
This is McCoy. Cuts it back. LaShawn McCoy. Run out inside the five.
All right, Coach Burnham, careful what you hope for here. You put it in his hands, he hits you with it. Now, you talk about shake and bake at the line of scrimmage. We've seen it now four or five times tonight where McCoy has made some outstanding open space moves.
Do you think Tyler Roberts was afraid of LaShawn McCoy right there, afraid to commit to that tackle, Chris?
You think old Tyler's had a tough night?
Oh.
Burn for the touchdown, couple of pass interference. May have lost his man Turner in coverage a second ago.
Well, you missed the tackle.
There's
going to
be nights like that in football, I guess. But
I guess.
He's having one of them. First and goal. It's McCoy in the I formation, gets the toss, cuts it back, touchdown. What an answer from Pittsburgh.
It feels like USF and Jesse Hester just scored a play ago, doesn't it?
Well, three plays ago they did.
Yeah, they did, absolutely.
Three plays ago they did, and that just tells you right there, that USF defense wasn't ready for the task to come back out and answer it.
He goes 60 yards in three plays. Second touchdown from McCoy.
Here's your foot, Jesse. Here's your foot now. Put your foot in the ground and get north.
See the cut. Understand the scheme.
How about my man Collins. Conrad. Great block, Collins.
Playing like Craig Hayward.
Go two here, guys. They're going to up five. And Wally Burnham, he felt good if he had the lead and still had the ball, but that wouldn't have worked out. But still time for Grothy, 4:43.
Yep.
Will this be a 5-point game or a 7-point game? We're going to use a timeout on defense. They had three. They'll spend one here on defense before this 2-point play. Play so efficiently behind the big offensive line. My guy, Anton Caldwell, the center for Alabama, made it pretty easy for John Parker down there in Athens.
Well, they did. There are a lot of players. You know, the thing that impressed me the most was the tenacity that they had in that game. You were there on the sidelines, but it just looked like Alabama came.
You see Grothy. He's going to get the football back. Will he be down five or down seven? They've got...
It looks like man-to-man coverage. I would be, wouldn't be surprised to throw a jump ball to one of their big receivers here.
Well, you can't throw a jump ball if you're going to drop the ball. Stahl just falls on it. He made a big pass in that drive. They don't get the two-point conversion. And Grothy will take over down five.
Yeah, you know what? You just, like Dave Wants there, are you kidding me? Not that there was anything there. I mean, we don't know if it was open or not, but...
At least he fell on it, didn't allow the Bulls to pick it up and run it back for two the other way.
Well, in the background there, you saw Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, and they're already trying to figure out exactly what they need to do here. I would not sit back. I think you've seen, if you sit back, you're going to get the ball run down your throat, or Grothy's going to hurt you with a big shot.
Now, both defenses kind of worn out at the end of this game. Offense is having their way.
That's where all of that hype that we heard all week about that two deep defensive line comes into play right now.
It's got to show up right now, absolutely. If there's one defensive line in this game that is able to step up right now because allegedly they're more fresh, we got to see it right now.
And EA, Buddy Wallace, a strength coach, it means a lot to this Pitt team.
Absolutely, CJ. You're the one that brought it up, actually, when they played Iowa. The guy said the defensive line got stronger as the game went on. And just talking to the coaching staff about him, they were saying the younger guys have benefited the most from this strength coach. He is tough on them. And Dave Wonstadt loves it.
Briggs to kick it off. He keeps it in bounds, which is good news. Nice kickoff. Drives Bogan back near the hole. Bogan breaking tackles. Had to be brought down at the 35. 33 yards on the return. Grothy fires near side. Makes a Love connection to A.J. Love, who gets it out across the 40. McKillop there on the tackle. They get six.
How about Greg Gregory changing it up? He started the last series running the football.
Yeah, getting it out early now, getting into the hands of his playmakers on the perimeter, trying to show this Pitt defense something new.
All the defensive coordinators have that concerned look on their face at this point in the game. It's Ford. Ford. He is whacked hard. Wow, big hit there by Rashad Duncan. After a short gain, it'll set up third and three.
But that just shows you the experience of Greg Gregory. You know, and thinking about it, feeling the game, knowing it, where he was, and comes back and gives him something different.
What do you call here on third and three? The running quarterback, you got lots of options if you're
remember,
Gregory.
They're not good on running third and short. They're better passing.
It's man-to-man again.
He tried to pass. Now he's chased. Grothy throws the ball away. They'll throw the flag for the obvious grounding. He was pressured. Three Panthers right on him.
Intentional grounding on the offense. Number eight. Loss of down. Fourth down.
Yeah, that's a crucial, crucial penalty. USF has a couple of timeouts, and they'll send out the punt team. Great pressure again.
Craig, you see here the pressure of the fresh D-line, but look at all the pressure coming from the second level as well. Phil Bennett doing a great job dialing up different pressure.
Duncan got there. McKillop was there. DeSico also in the blitz. Big stand by the Panthers on third and three, and they'll get the football back. Fair catch by Barry. Pittsburgh back on offense, inside three and a half. We've seen both defensive lines make some crucial plays tonight, rushing the passer. Just when you thought Pittsburgh's defense was wearing down, the nice call, they brought the house against Grothy on third and three.
Well, you know what? In the last drive that Pitt had offensively, it was quick, it was brief, it was three plays. But McCoy, they somehow at South Florida half got to find a way to bottle him up before he breaks loose.
You know, and Phil Bennett talked about this coming in the game. There's different ways you can pressure Matt Grothy. You can send one guy at a time and try to get a mismatch versus someone blocking, or you can send the house, and they did it right there.
This is Stevens howling, not McCoy in the game, and he'll lose yardage. And they'll stop the clock with a timeout.
Like that, because, you know, otherwise you let the clock bleed down and it's 40 seconds off of it, and then you get pressed up against the wall. Too many coaches let the clock bleed down, and they don't have timeouts, and then it just eats them up.
All right, let's see here. On second and 11, it is McCoy back in the game. He's got it. Some big bodies in front of him, but they shoot the gap. That was McKenzie flying in to make the tackle. It'll be third and about nine.
That is a top 10 football team making a play defensively. They had to suck it up and get from the inside out to stop McCoy, because they had that set up for a nice game.
It took right tackle Joe Thomas a long time to get outside to seal that block, and LeSean McCoy was on his heels quickly, and that USF defense able to just really swallow that whole play up.
You throw it, take a chance of it hitting the ground.
I don't know.
What if you're aggressive? Dave Wanstead said it.
Now they fake the throw, hand it off to McCoy. McCoy makes a man miss. Heads for the sidelines, gets out of bounds, but gets the first down.
How many times tonight have we seen LeSean McCoy take it upon himself in third and long and convert these huge first downs?
And you can get a pass for going out of bounds when you get a first down like this. Now I want to watch. The defensive guy waits on McCoy to get there. You cannot wait. Here he is on the outside. You got to go get him. You've got to go get him. Cannot let him dance.
There's Jerome Murphy. Couldn't corral the running back there. And now, with just one timeout remaining, it's going to be tough for the Bulls. The clock running again inside of 2:15. McCoy buys the other corner. Picks up about four. Hale on the stop. Level will have to use his final timeout here.
Well, and again, South Florida blew a timeout on the two-point conversion down here just a little while ago, right? They'd love to have that in their pocket right now.
Watching this USF defense right now, it looks as though they're afraid to tackle LeSean McCoy. They're not sure what he's going to do. Is he going to try to run them over or run outside of him? And LeSean McCoy all night tonight has done an excellent job of staying the course, trusting in the scheme, putting his foot in the ground, seeing his cuts, and getting north, Craig.
You know what? It came out in this game plan here. Pitt's plan was to run the football to see if South Florida could stop them. They've been able to do that tonight. And the space, the open space, the foot in the ground, the cuts, the power, the rush chart, it's clear. This is a strong game. Four carries for 28 yards to the left side. But look at the middle of the field, huh? That's called the heart of the defense.
This has been a different LeSean McCoy we've seen now the last 2 weeks. From the Syracuse game on Saturday to today, just trusting in the scheme, not trying to hit home runs each and every time he carries the football. He's looked a lot better today and against Syracuse.
Yeah, that was his first 100-yard game of the season. Yeah. Against the Orange, he had 149. It's not always easy for a running back to come back on a short week after a 100-yard game and do it again. He's got that second straight 100-yard game now, a 132 tonight. McCoy still in the game. He's got it again, bouncing it, fighting forward. It'll be third and about three. Bulls cannot stop the clock, so if they can get this first down, pick up 3 yards, Wanstead is going to go home with a big, big road victory to make Pittsburgh relevant again.
He's got a very good coaching staff. Matt Cavanaugh at offense court. There's Tony Wise right there. Used to be with the Dallas Cowboys with Dave. Tony's been around a long time. This is one of the best offensive coaches, line coaches in America.
See if his guys can create enough room for McCoy. Third and three, ball game here for the Bulls defense. Flag before the play. A false start's going to make it tougher now.
False start on the offense on the 56. 5 yard penalty.
Now you talk to your guy up as an offensive line coach, and his guy goes out there and makes a false start.
It's just inevitable. Look at Tony.
Oh, man.
He'd tell me, Craig, don't ever say anything good about my offensive line. You jinxed them.
And we'll see what they do on third and eight. Again, USF can't stop the clock, so you just hand it off, wind it down, punt it, play defense.
Yeah.
That's the call. McCoy just protecting that football. Wrapped up at the 46. Grothy gets the hat on, gets ready, but he will not have much time.
Well, here's a punt formation now. We've seen USF get after this thing twice. They've had a block. They've had a near block. You incorporate the Florida Gators spread punt formation this year. Man, oh, man, I bet there's a lot of people's hearts pounding right now on that pit sideline.
I tell you what the punter's been told to do. Catch it and punt it. We'll put the clock on him. Get Blackie up here with the stopwatch going. He better be in the 1-8 category, Blackie.
Let's see now. Play clock at 8. Brightus has had his troubles here. Looks like they're just going to call timeout. Not hurry things. Get the protection all settled. And you see that the Bulls needing a touchdown. Going to have to go a long way. I won't have much time. You're right. Spending that timeout when they had to, defending the two-point conversion proves big. Yeah, big difference that they had one more timeout. They'd have a whole lot more time to work
probably
with
an
offense.
Probably at least a minute. At least a minute. But, you know, when you look at this game and for South Florida, they're going to go back, and you have to realize this was a football team that came in here. They were beat up on the defensive line. They were thin at linebackers. They only had 4 guys on their unit. They played a valiant game, but Dave Wannstedt, you could sense that he felt like, dude, we're coming in here and we got you.
I just feel like they understood kind of the significance of this football game. We talked earlier, they had that bad loss week one to Bowling Green. A lot of people wrote him off, but they have a chance to right the course right now, get back on track, and pull this win out.
You see Staldo showing some leadership, trying to get the guys up off the bench, get them near the sidelines. Crucial punt. 10 men on the line for the Bulls. They come after it. Reddish gets it away. Hogan spun around, wrapped up at the 28-yard line. 1.9 seconds, says Mike Black, our spotter.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mike. That's called get rid of the football. 2.0 or better, and you're in good shape. 1.9, you know you got a chance.
What was your get-off when you played at SMU?
I went to two-step punting, and it really helped me a lot. And 2.0 or better is what everybody goes for. It eliminated a lot of over-kicking.
And Grothy needs a miracle now. No timeouts, 22 seconds. 72 yards away, rolls out. He's pressured by a 3-man rush. Grothy gets away, skips out with 16 seconds. Trying to get close enough, I guess, to reach the end zone with a Hail Mary. He's not the strongest arm throwing the ball downfield.
Yeah, absolutely. But you know what? Here's a guy that can buy time. Relax. You're out of bounds. Relax. Take a moment here. Don't push it, but you got to get to midfield.
If your defense per pick, keep everything in front of you.
A rush 3. Grothy taking a lot of time. Fires downfield. It's a catch made across midfield. They'll stop the clock momentarily. Bogan got it. 8 seconds, but they move the chains. The clock will run.
You got to spike this football right now. Clock it.
The clock starts. They do spike it. And they got 6 seconds to take a shot at the end zone.
Hey, they gave themselves a chance, didn't they, Jesse? They got the ball to midfield. They got a chance to get the ball down the field.
Let's get this. Do you guys think Matt Grothy can reach the end zone from here?
It's a stretch, really.
That's a long throw. We're going to be looking at probably a 60 to 55-yard throw here.
He has been compared to old Flutie Flakes Doug many times. If he pull this off, Flutie Flakes will send him a box.
Here it is. Game's final play. Grothy winds up, heaves it from his own 47 to the goal line. Incomplete. Ball game over. Another Thursday night upset. Hugs all around for Wannstedt. They stumbled badly in the opener at home to Bowling Green. This, he said, could maybe make up for it and stall him in offense. Trailing for the big march down the field. A satisfying win for Pittsburgh. First loss for the Bulls. Let's go to Aaron with the winning coach. Yeah.
Chris, thanks. Well, Matt Grothy, for the past 2 years, has actually burned you guys on some pretty big plays. What was your mindset with that last one right there?
Well, he's a great player, and the debate was, do we give him time to throw it or try to pressure him? Our defensive line did a great job the whole game of pressuring him, so we stayed in a 4-man rush. Offense made some plays. I mean, defense, it was a great win. You know, it's these guys got a real good football team. We needed this so bad for our program to give us a chance to take a step. I'm so happy for these kids and these coaches. They did a great job.
Everybody had been asking us how big this win was for you personally.
Forget about me. This is about Pitt. Thank you.
All right, Chris, there
you
go.
Yeah, but he's been on the hot seat. There have been a lot of critics, and they came after him in his program after losing to Bowling Green in the opener. But now Pittsburgh, 4-1. They're 2-0 in the Big East. They're in first place in the conference.
It's interesting. You know, they come in tonight. They get a big win over a ranked opponent. Look at LeSean McCoy and his numbers, what he put up.
Yeah, the old Wrangler player of their game there. Not a bad game for McCoy.
Yeah, second 300-yard game.
You know what, though? This and what it means to Dave Wannstedt and his coaching staff is that they can continue to build on what they're doing. They have young football players that came through when they had to come through tonight. And on Thursday night, where a lot of recruits are watching, it helps them.
Remember, Vanderbilt goes down. Rutgers goes down. West Virginia goes down. USC goes down.
Where are we at next week, Chief?
Upsets happen on Thursday night, the fifth straight. Pittsburgh comes down to Tampa, hands the Bulls their first defeat. Another ranked team goes down. A presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Craig, Jesse, and Aaron, and our entire team in Tampa, I'm Chris Fowler. So long for now.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough, delighted to have you with us, and happy holidays to you all. As tonight we get a look at two programs with very similar...